Almost. So Reed, not officially.
Reed, Chadwick Boseman.
Yeah, R.I.P.
So I've never seen Black Panther.
What? Bro. Wakanda, bro? Are you kidding me? That's like heaven, bro.
Krista, I hear Krista laughing. Like, I don't even know what is Raquan. What is that?
Raquan, chill out. Yeah,
I don't even know if I can be on this anymore, dude. I think I don't
know. I'm serious. Like,
we live though.
but that's why we're here, is to educate one another. I don't know. I've never seen Black Panther, so.
Bro, Wakanda has like
streaming tonight.
Utmost technology, bro. It's like the best place ever, dude. Like,
so is it just for is it just for Black Panthers, or
that's a good question.
I tried watching one of the Thor movies. I made about halfway through. I've watched like the ending of like a few on YouTube, but that's about it. I've never really seen a few of the old Spider-Mans.
What a great way to start the show.
Right. First of all, R.I.P. Chadwick Boseman. And welcome to Chestnut Checkers. We here again with a special surprise guest host.
Guest host,
this
correct.
Is not an interview. This is guest host Zach Penprase. Everybody give him a round of applause.
Live from Wakanda.
We need a button with the crowd noise, man. We got to get our, next time you come, we're going to have that on deck.
Yeah.
But what's up, Zach? Welcome to the show, bro.
What's up, y'all? So thanks for having me. This is awesome.
Zach is live from... Zach, would you like to tell them where you're live from?
I'm from Oakville, which is outside of Toronto, Canada. So up here in the Great White North.
What's the temperature like up there right now?
Oh, it's good, man. It's hot and humid, man. Today was windy, but...
burning down here.
It's good, dude. It's good. It's not too bad.
It just rains every hour on the hour here at
we didn't even really get hit too bad from the hurricane in we're in Mississippi from around the Jackson area. Just rain for the most part. They said it was gonna be awful, but it wasn't as bad. Reed, y'all got a lot down there?
No, it didn't. We when it came hard, but we didn't really get that much. Now, to the west of us in Lafayette, Lake Charles, that area, there was a lot of damage done. I seen some pictures, and there was some relief effort and things like that that people are putting together. So those people out there are really going through it. But fortunately, in Baton Rouge, New Orleans, it passed us this time.
It was Hurricane Laura, right?
Yes.
Where do they come up with the names? Laura. You said, what was the other one?
Marco.
First time I ever experienced a tornado down in Mississippi, I was in the bathtub crying with like...
Itabena? Like at college?
Yeah, it was in that house, dude, that party house, bro. And I was like, our house is going to fly away. I'm going to die. This is my first time crying, dude. And Sheena's like, dude, you're like, you're fine. Like, we're all here. We're all here together. You're good. I was like, no, you're gonna die.
Hey, I remember Katrina. Like, people don't even understand. Like, Itabena is like 5 hours away from New Orleans. So, when Katrina hit, of course, it was terrible down there. I'm watching the news. I'm like all in my feelings, and I'm, emotional about what's going on at home. But right, two doors down from me was Zach's house, where a tree fell on his truck.
I remember that. The Nissan just took out your whole Nissan.
That hurt, man.
I felt bad, man. I remember
we couldn't even get gas, and like it was even hard to call people at that time. Right, like we had to drive like out of town to get gas and stuff. And I remember Turk ended up just like leaving practice, and he just had to go look for his parents because he couldn't get a hold of them. So like people don't realize that like stuff was just going down. And we were just in college trying to figure it out, whatever. Like, let's just do it, And the tree fell in my truck 5 minutes after I got out of it. I could have been paralyzed, dude. Like, it would have chopped my legs off for sure.
Sure. It like crushed the truck for real. Like, all of the tree landed on all of the truck. For sure. Yeah, that's just one of many crazy memories that we got between the three of us, man, and the rest of our crew. Up bad during them times.
So Zach, what's going on? I mean, you're living in Oakville right now, or I know you're there visiting. Where are you spending most of your time at, or where have you spent most of your time at the past, you know, 6 months since all this COVID shutdowns and stuff started?
Earth, bro. I've been on Earth for the last 6 months, man.
That's a good thing.
Final frontier.
Challenge like everybody else, man. Now, we were in Southern California in Camarillo. So for those of you guys that don't know me that listening, I'm from Moorpark, California, Southern California. And then I just decided to go to the Deep South and play ball in Mississippi at Valley, man. And man, honestly, guys, I miss that place, dude. I really do. Like, I miss just having a simple life and going to eat catfish, you know, a couple times a week and and just like, you know, going to the yard and hanging out, bro. And like, you know, drinking a couple cups and hanging out with the boys. Like, that was like the life, and there's nothing like it anymore. So I, right now we're just hanging out in Camarillo, living down in Southern California. And yeah, now I got a kid and one on the way in a couple months. So it's exciting.
Man, that's, yeah, I mean, you're just talking about just, you know, the simplicity of life itself, especially in college playing ball. You know, so many kids have had that taken away from them this past year, you know. High school seniors didn't get to finish their baseball season. You know, college players as well. It's affecting a lot of football players. You know, we fortunately just had our first football scrimmage here last night, and it was just a bit of normalcy, you know. It was nice just seeing the kids enjoying themselves, and it sucks for all the kids not getting to experience that, you know, for however long that may be, because everybody's doing stuff different, you know. I mean, I don't know what's going on in California, but I know from me to Baton Rouge, where Reed is, it's totally different, you know.
Yeah, look, we ain't playing ball right now, so you know, Louisiana had to pretty much sit back and watch all the other states get their grind on the field, you know, competing against other kids. And you know, we couldn't practice this week because of hurricane already, so that was bad enough. But you know, we had our scrimmage, or our jamborees was scheduled for this weekend, and we couldn't play. And so now everybody's like pissed and questioning, like, why everybody else get to play and our kids can't play? Like, you know, they deserve it, and that's where I'm at with it. I want them to be able to compete. I know they do, and if other people are competing safely, then we should have opportunity as well. What do you have any idea? Are they playing in Cali?
Yeah, they're like playing some tournaments and stuff here and there. Most people were traveling to Arizona for some tournaments, and then they kind of shut Arizona down for like a month as far as like tournaments and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So some of the kids that, you know, that were able to afford it, that would go to these showcases or these tournaments or whatever. But locally in my area, kind of everything was just, you know, there was no extracurricular activities. And I understand for the first couple months, but at this point for me, you know, I'm on a different level where like, I don't even think kids should be wearing masks. You know, I think if you're not in high school, you should be, I don't even think high school kids should be wearing masks. So like, I think it's ridiculous to go look out. And I went to a game out here in Toronto, and I was watching these 10-year-old kids play baseball with masks on.
No way.
And to me, I'm like they're 10, they're outside. They're not even really close to each other unless they get on base. Right. Or they're hitting or whatever it is. And like really, are we really doing that to our kids? And now we have this awkward feeling amongst, you know, these kids don't know.
So awkward.
When we're leaving the house, it's like, you know, my nieces are here, and one's 10, one's 6, and the 6-year-old lost her mask for a second. It was like this 10 minutes of stress for this mask. And I was like, guys, like a 6-year-old doesn't, first of all, a 6-year-old doesn't need to be wearing a mask. Like, second of all, a mask, like, isn't, it's not like a lifesaver. Like, we need to be focusing on how to actually take care of each other. You know, how can we actually prevent the spread? And it's not just simply just masks. Like, there's way more to that.
Yeah, I agree with that. It's so, got to like, be deeper than just a mask, right?
There's so much to it. And right, and when it came to like kids canceled seasons and stuff like that, like at first I was like, yeah, that sucks. But at the same time, like they're still young, dude. Like I had the Olympics canceled, bro. You know, like that was a complete letdown, you know? And right. So I was in the feeling too. It was like, But you just got to kind of say like, oh, well, you know, what now? Like, you know, how, and make it a part of their story. I think it's kind of cool. Like, some of these kids are going to go on and succeed and do more than they would have done. Because now this is like resilience time. And this is actually becoming a part of their story. So like, I'm kind of excited. Yeah, everybody should have the right to like mourn the loss of their season and be upset. Like, definitely. Like, totally. But if you're feeling sorry for yourself for the next couple years because of it, you know, nobody really cares about that. Nobody's gonna listen to you whine and complain about it because everybody on the planet had to go through it.
Right.
So I
totally agree, man. Because my down here, we played, you know, I coach travel ball. You know, we played about 8 tournaments, I think, this summer, and starting from the end, like the beginning of June through July. So, you know, I've been coaching, you know, no mask worn. I coached 12 U-ball. And, you know, we played and everybody was at the park with no mask on. And, you know, they put the mask as a mandate, like one tournament. And then like nobody really was following it. I did. But, you know, just because I don't want to disrespect, you know, the facility itself and the people who run it. But
yeah, I get that.
Like, other people just like, whatever, we ain't wearing no mask. We yeah, weren't wearing them on the field. So it was like, you know, if I could coach all those tournaments, I feel like I'm comfortable enough coaching, you know, 8 football games, 9-10 football games, or hopefully more if we was able to advance forward. So
yeah. I mean, right now I work at the Dodgers Training Academy and it's actually backed by the Dodgers, not just a name on the front. Mm-hmm. And so like my brother's the manager there. And so we have to wear a mask because the Dodgers have deep pockets, right? And we're in California. People love to sue and they see Dodgers. They'll just do it just to get that, you know, just the Dodgers will settle and give them 20 grand. Yeah. So I'm with you, Reed. Like, I got to respect the facility. I got to do that. But really in the back of my mind, I'm like, this is really like, you're pulling it down anyways. To be like, because you can't really hear through the mask. You like, you say what 100 times, you're, hey, blah, 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 blah. And then people wear those clear visors or whatever. And I'm like, what's the difference between this and me just putting my hand right here and talking, you know, like, you know, so, and let me tell you this though, guys, this is, I've been seeing, you know, hypocrisies and just, it's ironic, right? How can like, when you're eating, you don't have to wear a mask. You obviously you can't catch it when you're eating. And then I went to a trampoline park today. And if you're sitting around the trampolines, you have to wear a mask. But if you're on the trampolines and you're active, you don't have to wear a mask. So you can't catch it while you're active, supposedly. But if you're just sitting there, then out of respect.
Yeah, there's definitely no consistency with it. And I think you're right, Zach. Like, people are focused so much on the mask instead of saying like, hey guys, worry about your health, start exercising daily, take some vitamins, vitamin C, get out in the sun. And it's like the lockdowns and all of that. And the, you know, the mandates that's forcing people to not get out and to not socialize. And, you know, a large thing that goes unnoticed, like people, if people's mental health is suffering, their physical health will also suffer greatly.
No doubt.
You know what I mean?
And vice versa too as well.
Yeah, it's
vice. Right. So it's
both of them connected. We want to know.
You know, just from the stats of, you know, suicide rates going up, domestic violence, just, you know, so a lot of kids have gotten behind on, you know, whatever our American timeline is for education at, you know, certain points in their
developmental stages.
Yeah, you know, and because a lot of parents hadn't been doing the work to keep their kids, you know, I guess up to date on things. But
right.
I don't know, man. It's like I said, I feel like everybody should have the freedom in America to either wear a mask or not wear a mask. For certain places to mandate it, we all know that's about liabilities and like you talked about getting sued, you know, it's they want to take all the precautions that were technically mandated for people. You know what I mean? But I think in Mississippi here right now, our mask mandate's actually coming to an end possibly soon. You know,
we just got extended for phase 2 for another 3 weeks, I think. So phase 2 means no football, like no full gear practice. You know, we go half of our students at school, half at home. The hurricane, man, I had 2 days of all virtual teaching of like just sitting in the house, you know, with all my students online on Google Meet, you know, trying to keep them occupied. And, you know, it's just a weird thing. I survived it. I think I did a good job, but I gave my kids, like, we had like stretch routines during class. You know what I'm saying? Like, we had like a time where they like talked about what they grateful for and things like that. Like, we just, you know, this ain't school right now. I just want to check in and make sure that your minds are focused on things that are important, and then we can start learning.
That's huge.
I mean,
it was fun, actually.
But I mean, like, Zach, you're talking about masks. The schools are requiring kids to wear masks, like, inside the school. We went
to. Oh, yeah, for sure.
But yeah, we
my
went
kid's
to,
not going to school then. Sorry, dude. I'm homeschooling my kid. And I don't even know, like, there's so, like, guys, honestly, like, let's cut to it, dude. Like, we've been bitching about our systems have been broken for a long time, including our education system. And I'm glad that you guys are teachers, man, because you guys are in the system. You guys are doing your part, and you guys have that much passion. That's great, right? But why are we trying to hold on to something that we know needs to be fixed, right? So we're trying to hold on to something when we have a chance to revamp the whole thing. So no, we got to hold on to it. We got to hold on. And in California, the teacher unions are just ridiculously strong. So, like, it doesn't even really matter what the kids want or need. It's just what the teachers care about. And mm-hmm. Yeah, dude, guys, like, you guys know more than anybody, I care about human life. But at the same time, that goes into our mental state too. Like, we can't mentally keep doing this to our kids. And really, like, now's our chance to fix some of this stuff, but we seem to be trying to hold on to it all. Like, why are we trying to hold on to something when we know we could learn so much stuff online? We know homeschooling is good. If you want to send your kid to school for the social aspect and because there's good teachers at that school, awesome. But for the most part, like, most of our school system sucks, dude. And, like, that's just real talk, dude.
Look, I think, and I feel you on that, because if you look at the rankings, you know, every year of education, who comes in top, and I guess it's based off test scores and whatnot and grading or whatever the scoring system is, it's probably skewed and doesn't really truly reflect, you know, what the students are capable of. But Louisiana is habitual 49th. Or 48, you know, bottom, and Mississippi usually, like, whatever,
right around you guys, yeah. But yes. But it, you know, so it's like, but it's not fair.
We do need to, like, improve some things and get our rank up at least.
This is something that a guy from California never knew about, because private schools in California are different than the private schools in the South. So when I tell people that, like, most of the time, like, you know, and a lot of people aren't going to like to hear this, but, like, school, private schools in the South, white schools, bro. Public schools in the South, black schools, right? And now, I mean, that's what it was, bro. There was very few people that went to a private school that was black. That was a person of color, right? So, like, that blew my mind when I first saw Pillow Academy, and I was just like, wait, every white person in the town goes to Pillow? And then, like, every black dude from Greenwood goes to, you know, Greenwood High, or, you know, and, like, you know, like, what, like, what is going, like, what is really going on? So, like, you know, I don't really necessarily, I personally don't like to necessarily call it systemic racism. I just call it systemic oppression, right? So, like, we can just totally squash race totally right now, because really, in the end, all they care about is the oppression of mass amounts of people. Doesn't matter if it's black, white, doesn't matter. If they find a way to oppress you, they're going to do it.
Well, to touch on the school situation, like with private schools, we've discussed that on here before. You know, they were originally created, you know, when they said, all right, you know, we're going to let black and white people go to the same school, then there was a lot of white people that were like, okay, we're going to go start our private schools. But to your point, Zach, I think that's true at Pillow. I have a good friend who coaches basketball there, named Wes Prather, who I went to high school with. And it's gotten better at places like Pillow, you know what I mean? Where it's not just all white people, but there's a lot of places in Mississippi, specifically where I am, where the black population has increased greatly at a lot of private schools.
That's awesome. That's really good to hear.
And most of our public schools are, you know, mostly mixed. I mean, the one that I teach at, you know, is about 65% Black, maybe. The other 35% is mostly white and Hispanics, you know, but it's definitely, I enjoy my kids going to a school that's multicultural. You know what I mean? I mean, I went to a private school and we had 27 kids in a class, you know, not even, you know, 200 kids in our high school. And we maybe had, you know, 10 Black kids, you know what I mean? So, but then where I went to college was completely reversed, but I never looked at it like that. Just like I know you didn't either, Zach. But that's how most people view it in terms of, you know, what kind of school it is, I guess, so to speak. But
Now it's going to happen again with homeschooling, right? Like if you have the opportunity to homeschool, and I think everybody actually has the opportunity now. Like I feel it's almost a level playing ground at this point to where it's like, okay, people are creating these affordable homeschools to where like, we don't really necessarily have, like, we could stand up to the system and be like, nah, like, all right, fine. You don't want to do that in school. Fine. Like, we're just going to pull our kids out and we're going to start this awesome multicultural homeschool. And now my kids are going to get life. They're going to learn about life. They're going to be interacting with everybody. Like I went to a high school, this is what we talked about. Like what's white, what's Black, right? Like my hometown was built by Mexicans. And so like there was a lot of Mexicans that went to my high school, a lot of white people. And then there was like a, you know, very few Black people. And so, but I feel like even just having that culture of that Mexican culture where I grew up, you know, hanging out with these guys, you know, like what the homes, you know, just messing around with them. And that kind of helped me at least see different sides of things. And where you said that, like, okay, like, oh, Blacks are going to go to school now. Okay. The white people just started private schools. I think that's what's happening now with homeschool, but I think everybody now has the opportunity to do it, not just white people. I think that everybody is like, okay, we can create these awesome homeschools, and I think they're going to be created because mix in now, I think mandatory vaccines might come into play. And so like, that's going to make a lot of people upset. And so, you know, mandatory masks at the moment, and there's all sorts of other things. I think the only thing that people hold on to is like the sports aspect, but you can get private sports other places too. So, I mean, I don't know. So I bring that up just because I never really knew that was an aspect of segregation was like the private public school thing.
The schools, I didn't know that. Yeah. Well, I mean,
it's the same in Baton Rouge, in Louisiana. In the more rural areas, that's where you really see it more. But you see it also in the bigger cities, but a lot of the private schools in Baton Rouge was open to recruiting, you know, those Black athletes that was
yes,
you know,
the they, mm-hmm. happens like a lot.
Travis Minor and Warwick Dunn, and you know what I'm saying, guys that you might have heard about that went to, you know, private schools in Baton Rouge, but they, you know, from the neighborhood, but Darius Geis, another one, you know what I'm saying? Hope, you know, peace and blessings to that brother, you know what I'm saying? But he was another one who grew up, and he would have went, I would have been coaching Darius Geis if he went to his neighborhood public school. But the private schools, they have a tendency to kind of take those guys out and give them opportunities that they might not have had at the public schools. But also, you know, that's kind of a drain on the public schools here in Baton Rouge specifically, and New Orleans as well too.
Okay, so
in a period, the private schools really do a great job of recruiting those better Black athletes, you know.
All right, so Reed, and Zach, you may not know this. Listen, we had an all Black private school around Jackson that was called Christ Missionary Industrial School. Small school. Remember Julius Love? That's where he came from, Reed. Love.
Oh, you
know. Zach, did you ever know Julius Love played football?
I don't think so.
You're an Norman, Zach.
Anyway.
And I came to one of my parties, right?
Yeah.
a friend of mine, T-Mac Howard, from around this Northwest Rankin area, he started his own private school, basically for Black kids only, called Delta Streets Academy. So, Reed, like, If white people were like, hey, let's go start a bunch of private schools, why don't Black people like, hey, let's go start a bunch of all black private schools? Like, why don't
there are? That's a good question. There actually are a few, you know, that have been popping up here and there. Southern Lab is one that has been, you know, probably the oldest high school. I don't know if Southern Lab ever had a white student other than Chris Ossentop, who was a kicker that was a German exchange student that played on Marcus Spears' team. They went to the state championship. But it's a few, like, I think Mentorship Academy. They're mostly charter schools. I don't know if there are any actual private schools as far as, you know,
privately funded and everything.
I couldn't afford to go to private schools.
I couldn't afford to send my kids. It's one of those things where the public schools, like a lot of public schools around where I live, I'm sure where y'all live too, some are funded better than others, you know, whether it's through a booster club athletically, and some don't get any funding. You know, it's very sad that there's no consistency. You know, ironically, one of the, you know, poor school districts in our state is predominantly black, you know? So I don't know if that's a Department of Education problem. I don't know if that's just that school district specifically, but I mean, Zach, you're right. Talking about people starting their own schools. I mean, of course you got to have money and investors, but most of the private schools that are successful around here are basically run, you know, equally with a church, you know, where they have churches hold the kindergartner through sixth grade. They come up in like a Christian environment where they got Bible class and Bible study, things like that. And there's a lot of money coming into them. I mean, we're talking about like a cheap one within driving distance of me, maybe like 4,000, you know, I know a couple that are 10,000 a year. There's even, you know, some that are over 10 grand a year. Like, we're talking about college tuition.
Valley didn't cost that much.
No. But a lot of them guarantee that.
Out of state.
So tell me about this. Like, I heard a lot about, like, Trump, you know, putting a lot of money into the HBCUs. And when we went to school, it was like, you could get Valley. I heard the rumor. I don't know if this is true. Valley could have got massive amounts of funding, you know, if they took away the HBCU title. They could have got massive amounts of money from the government. But now supposedly Trump put in action, you know, a bunch of funding for HBCUs. Is this like a thing now for Valley or what?
I don't really know. I remember hearing that when we was in school, you know, and I remember hearing like you get like whatever the minority is at on your campus, that you get like extra funding to bring in to have diversity in your campus, you get more funding for it, basically. So whatever the majority is,
you reach like a certain point, minority, right? Like a certain percentage of like technically a minority, right?
You know, I mean, Zach, ironically, Valley benefited a lot from the years we were there, from like 2002 to probably even through 2008, maybe, because they had the highest percentage of minorities, so we were getting a lot of extra funding, which we didn't see none of the
parties, bro. I should get some of that money, man. I was recruiting on the regular, bro.
Right. I mean, I'm just saying, like, we didn't, you know, after we left, they got a new stadium and new gym. But that's funny you're talking about it, Zach. Like, every time we had white recruits for football, they were like, Trey, I need you to take them out. So every like, time. All right, man. And sometimes they'd give me their own money, literally like $35, like, you know, feed them dinner. You know what I'm saying?
Take them to Crystal.
But we would show them around. But the recruiting trips.
I remember riding into Gallant with the recruits.
We can't really talk about too many recruiting trip stories, you know what I mean? But we weren't doing nothing like the Louisville, you know, basketball men's team.
Oh, no.
We weren't doing, you know, we were just having fun being kids. We never got in any trouble, you know.
We just stole everything on campus.
We did have a lot of like floor mats going into our houses that said Valley on them and stuff, you know.
I don't even know if we should talk about this. I don't know if we can like arrest.
No, like, I want to talk about this one story because y'all got me wrong. And I already told a story about Butts and Blanco writing Reed on the practice field. You know, I was already in the coach's doghouse, and everybody show up to practice, and my name is written in the practice field on the 50-yard line, and coach is giving me hell behind it. But when it was homecoming, and y'all took, everybody knew it was baseball players, but they took.
Oh, yes!
They took the letters off Rice Totten Stadium. And put Nice Tit Stadium on them. So we had practice that next Sunday, and Coach Totten, I don't know if any of y'all did it, but I know Reed know who had something to do with it. I know Reed knows. I'm like, bro, you gotta, this is like the weekend after this practice where my name was on the field.
Oh my God.
Like, for real? I'm getting, I didn't know that y'all had did it, but I knew that y'all had did it, you know.
Had that been in today's age, social media, that would have been the greatest thing in the world. But I would love to know the details, Zach. Was there some sort of espionage, you know, were y'all dressed in all black? Because it's not like we have security around there that's really patrolling.
Right, who did the recon on that?
Yeah, I like how you guys just like threw it on me. Like
we want to know the plan. We want to know the plan. Who thought of it? Who thought of it? Who was like, hey, you know what would be funny if we made it say Nice Tit Stadium? Like whose thought was that? It had to be yours, right? Or Kevin? Was it Kevin Snow's?
It was all of it. It was me. And Alexis, it was mostly Alexis, bro. It was Alexis and me and Steve. I don't even know if I think it was that our first year, because Kevin was only there our first year, so I don't think Kevin was involved.
Kevin was gone.
Yeah, it was really just me, Steve, Alexis, and then I don't even know who else. I don't know. I'm not gonna throw anybody else under the bus, but yeah. I think we were just drinking and playing poker one night, and we're like, dude, let's go fuck with the stadium, right? And it was just like, and then like when we got to the school, we didn't even think about like messing with the letters. We were just like, hey, let's go get something from the school. Cause we, at that point, we were just like taking carpets and just like signs that were like thrown up, and we're just like snatching stuff, right? And then so we just all looked at each other like, yo, let's mess with the letters. And then,
how did y'all know that would come off? The fact that they would come off is shocking to me, that you could just pull. Have some tools or something, or what?
Bro, they literally are like on two screws, and you just lift them off the screw.
Oh, my God. That's so Valley. That's the most Valley thing I've ever heard in my life.
There was no, they could have probably blown off in a hurricane if it was strong enough. Like, I think there might have been a little bit of glue, but it was mostly just like, and then just like off the screws, and that was
right. Of course.
And then I don't know who came up with the idea to put Nice Tit, but I thought it was pretty funny.
How weird was it?
You know, this is gonna cost me my Valley, you know, Hall of Fame gig, bro. Like, they're gonna be like, put me in the Hall of Fame in Valley, and be like, nah, bro, we heard about your podcast where you freaking mess with the stadium, like you're out, dude. Like, you're banned.
Nobody listens. Man. No,
I think you're good.
Yeah, we'll be all right.
We don't get any votes, but we definitely gonna campaign for Zach Penprase for the Valley Sports Hall of Fame.
Sure. I don't know, man. I see all these people going into the Hall of Fame, bro. I don't know if they're gonna include me, man. Like, everyone's going like from our years, and I'm just like sitting back. They really are.
We've had a lot from our years. I feel like
Tyler Knight just got in, I think.
Yeah, tonight. And then didn't Tyrone get in there?
Tyrone did.
And I feel like Ashley Robinson got in there.
Did she really? I feel like Sonya should be on the ballot. Like, she went in one as a player and as a coach. You know what I mean? Coach, what about surely some of the softball girls, man, from those years.
Oh, bro, dude, like the whole team should be in there.
When they won four straight. I mean,
Tammy and B are in. They got in. They was brought in with Tyrone.
Okay. Okay. I missed that. Yep. Anyway, maybe even Doug Shanks, you know, deserves a vote, you know?
I don't know, man. All I know is, you know, who the most badass coach there was Stribb, bro.
Coach Stribb
was the man. No. Dude. I'll spend nights where I just watch hours of video on him, like where he's just talking and they go through his closet and like go through his suits. And I'm just like, this dude is so cool. Like, I just want to be like this.
That's
dude.
On YouTube?
Yeah, it's on YouTube.
We need to share those videos to the page, bro, for sure.
He always had the calmest demeanor. I never saw him like outside of just a really chilled, you know, he had this just zen type approach to things, even on the court. I mean, and Zach, you remember some of those basketball games where we were winning SWAC championships, they were intense inside the gym, you know, people yes. packed everywhere. But he, like I said, he just played it cool, man. It was as cool as his suits were for the most part. Coach Waddell did all the yelling for the most part.
Stribb would get intense when he felt like he needed to, but for the most part, he was always cool.
Hold on, Zach. I've already told the story about swim class. Do you remember? I told him how we tested out in like a day. I was like, Zach was like, we were close, and I was like, Zach, listen, if you want to ease, he knows it. I was like, if you want to test a good class, take advanced swimming and beginning swimming. You could test out in the day. And sure enough, I brought Zach in there, and we were like racing, swimming laps and stuff. But
well, the thing was is that the first day he said, "Hey guys, if you feel that you can take the test right," and like he said it to everybody. He just like mm-hmm. presented the whole class like, "Hey guys, if you feel like you can just take the final test right now, you can take it and not have to come to class for the rest of the semester." And I was like, "Okay,
let's do it." Just
took the test, and it was like 30, not even 30 minutes. It was probably like 15, 20 minutes. And next thing you know, he's like, "All right, y'all, just have fun. And, like, you got to right. go for the rest of the semester." I was like, "What the?"
How awesome would it be if there was so many classes like that where you could just let's just say you were so advanced in algebra. So when you took college algebra, you could be like, "Hey, can I just take the final exam and test out if I passed it or something?"
This is what I'm saying, though. Like, we waste
so much of our time.
We waste so much of our time taking the class just because, like, we have to. And it's like,
we have to.
What is this bullshit? Like,
Zach.
Can I learn something that I'm going to use? Like, I don't even know what a mortgage is still. I'm 35 years old. I don't know how to refinance a house. I don't know how to, like, what? What? Like, I can learn this on my own, but come on, man. Like,
you're exactly. And it's not just college courses, it's high school courses that.
Yeah, it should be starting like, high school.
I mean, technically, kids need to be given options because. You know, kids through high school, they're 18, 19. They're still kids. They are still kids mentally, development-wise. But yet, even in college high school levels, you know, I took one math in college algebra.
Me too.
And I know, and there were so many classes that I enjoyed taking to help me be a teacher, like sociology and, you know, psychology, kinesiology, anything that had to do with what I wanted to do, like my passion, my profession. But taking English Lit too, because I need the credit to get my bachelor's degree.
Yeah.
I mean, there's certain things that don't.
I want to take a cooking class or like an agriculture class. I want to learn how to grow some plants.
Exactly. Right. Or just a business class. I took a music appreciation, like intro to music. I walked in the class. This guy took his job so serious that after about 30 minutes, I'm sitting there. And there was a few football players to my right, a few to my left. And we all were just like, man, we're out of here. And we just walked out of it. Like, I think it was Goldman. It was a white guy, yeah. Goldman or something.
Yeah, he was.
It was difficult. He was wanting us to remember Bach and all kind of stuff. Like, man.
Look, now, look, hold up. Time out. We are HBCU in the heart of the Mississippi Delta. When was the last time somebody listened to Bach? You better put on some Pac, and then we can appreciate damn music. Nobody want to listen to no Bach, man. What is that? Put that Pac on and that big, and then you can have an appreciation for the music and the art and the culture.
Okay. But let's
now we're talking.
But deeper in terms of just a funding thing, right? We fund education generally as a whole, publicly. We talk about the private schools. It's really strange how the majority of private schools, the big ones, you know, the ones with the money, man, they got top facilities. They're, you know, 80% of their graduates are getting scholarships and they're on the news and they're getting articles written about them in the paper and they got all this publicity and whatnot. There's some public schools, I would say 50-50 are right there with the private schools. The other 50% are horribly funded because they have don't have a lot of parents that are involved in, you know, supporting their kids. And it's like that with colleges too. I mean, look at look how poor Valley is. I saw Jackson State was doing a fundraiser, right? Mm-hmm. They've raised $146,000. Their goal is $400,000. I keep seeing this Valley fundraiser link sent to all the, our alumni. I wonder how many people have actually donated from Valley. I mean, we just don't have – the school's been around since 1950. You know what I mean? It's not like we have generations of donors or whatever, but me and Reed are always advocating for more public school education. I mean, like, why not? What are we doing? Why would you not put the majority of your funding? Talking
about the classes that mean, like, if you got a curriculum that don't, like, cater to...
We're wasting money. We're wasting money.
People, your students, they're not going to really... Nobody going to really want to come to Valley to study Bach, man. You know what I'm saying? That's... we making fun of it, but, like, literally nobody want to do that. And I had to take art appreciation. You know what I'm saying? I didn't... Oh my God.
It was, but Reed, we teach high school kids. We teach high school kids. So, you know, as well as I do, like, I mean, whether it's music or art or, you know, chemistry, you're going to have great teachers in those positions. But if a kid knows at 18, a senior year of high school, he doesn't want to do anything related to chemistry, why are we mandating that this kid passes chemistry, passes the state test? Is he not wasting time and are we not wasting money putting funding into that when the majority of kids want to be at the Votech building focused on how to be a mechanic or a chef, you know, in the, you know, the cafeteria, whatever. It's kind
of
crazy.
Yo, speaking of Bach, do you guys know a couple of months ago when they started coming out with Mozart and how they were saying how Mozart was black and they started doing all these tight ass videos like with Mozart music and stuff? Did you see that? That was the best thing.
I've been heard that, man.
It doesn't really matter. Like in my mind, this whole thing started coming up with like Jesus is black and Mozart's black. And in my head, I'm like, does it really matter, bro? Like it really like. I get that we want to relate to people, but like, does it really matter? It's all about like their character and how they lived and how they produced. Like, I understand that like, it's really important. And then to your point, you know, Reed is like, I was an art major, so I loved art history, mm-hmm. but it wasn't until recently that I started learning about black art history. It's right. Like, I went to an HBCU and like, why didn't I learn more about the black art history? All this like Roman stuff and like it was all great stuff, you know, like it was all great mm-hmm. stuff, right? Mm-hmm. So like I know what kind of column is that column. It's a Corinthian column and like all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I went to an HBCU. There should have been a black art history class, but there wasn't, and I didn't learn that. And so
wasn't an African American literature class. Look, let me respond to that, Zach, because I think it's important, the images of Jesus and the images of all of our people that we look up to, you know, when all of them are white, as we was growing up, that's all we saw, you know what I'm saying? Jesus and it's an all black church, white Jesus up at the front. So what that does to you, you know, what you internalize that and you look at whiteness as holy, you know what I'm saying? You don't see yourself in the Bible. You don't see yourself, you know, in a spiritual way. So a lot of people, you know, worship whiteness and look at blackness as something that's not worth the same. So not saying that it really shouldn't matter, but actually it does, unfortunately, because that's just, you know.
So
but that's so where the message gets mixed. That's where the message gets mixed, because like for me, my favorite people that I admired in professional sports growing up were black dudes. My favorite baseball player of all time is Ozzie Smith. And so like, you know, like I'm not up here going, you know, like, oh, I can't be Ozzie Smith because I'm not black. Like, it's just about admiring the characteristics of these people. You know, like I'm a mental coach now. So like, I believe that if you admire something about that person, you already have it within you. You can connect with it. Like, that's what I fully believe. And so, but here's my beef. My beef is you're totally right, is because the message of Jesus gets mixed up in the race of it. And actually, it's just about how he lived. It's about his character and how he forgave people before they did anything. He was like, he walked around in a state of forgiveness and he walked around loving everybody. And I totally agree. Why did we portray him as a white dude? I don't really know. And you're right. It shouldn't really matter, but I understand how it does.
Zach, no, I mean, I agree with you too, Zach. And real quick, Ozzie Smith, maybe the best nickname in baseball, the Wizard of Oz ever. I mean, the dude used to do like two backflips, taking the field. I mean, he was incredible.
He's your favorite player too, Reed?
Griffey, my favorite player, but Ozzie, my number one shortstop for sure, hands down. Yeah. When he plays short, that's why you love him.
Hey, so, all right, Reed, I got a question for you, all right? Because you're exactly right. You talked about all-black church, going into the and seeing the white Jesus or whatnot. How come so many black families, like when you walk into the church, you know, they'll have pictures of a black Jesus. You know what I mean? There's some churches that do that. And there's nothing but black angels and, you know, people of, I guess, symbols that were always white figures that, you know, they've just like the whole black Santa Claus thing. You know what I mean?
Right.
I see, that's what I think gets mixed up, because Santa Claus. Jesus, I mean, I believe in Jesus, just like Zach was talking about. It's about how he lived. I believe right. in the Bible. I read the Bible. So I believe in how he lived. And I that's what I try to do, is, you know, live, you know, to an extent, you know, in the same aspects of life that he was. I have people like my grandmother to thank for that, you know, just on how she's lived her life and whatnot. But it gets mixed up, because people try to deny that he's real, you know, because of his skin color, if that makes sense. You know, some don't want to accept it. Now, if we're talking about Santa Claus, listen, man, we should have got rid of Santa Claus a long time ago. Like, I don't even lie to my kids. If my kids, both of my kids, when my son was old enough to ask me, he was like, "Dad, is Santa Claus real?" I'm like, "Nope, he's not. I've been lying to you this whole time. There's no such thing as a white Santa Claus. That's not real. Neither is the Easter Bunny while we're on it. Neither is the Tooth Fairy. So, you know what? Sorry, buddy. But, we, you know, if you want
to. We used to have Christmas cards in the Walmart in Greenwood. They used to have the black Santa cards, dude. And I love getting those, dude. I was like, heck yeah, bro. Like, man.
But what I'm saying is that, you know, Reed, I think you're right. You talked about the white holiness, right? So even going back to the days of, you know, civil rights, hey, looking at the Mississippi lynching post in the museum, there were people that claimed to believe in Jesus, or at least live a Christian life, that owned slaves and whatnot. You know what I mean? And and I think that a lot of that gets intertwined, but you know, we're too educated of a you know, society now to think that that's real. But yet, it's like, weird, man. We decide as a society what we're going to lie about and what we're not going to lie about. So for some people, it's like, so Ava's like, my daughter Ava, she's like, so Santa's not real? I was like, no, baby. So, and she's like, but you all, you know, you told me that, you know, we don't see him. He comes at night and stuff like that and gives us presents, whatever. But I'm trying to tell her that Jesus is real. But Dad, I don't see Jesus. You know what I mean? Like, you know, so the correlation there, I think, gets this mixed up. And that's why I've never lied to my kids if they ask me. You know what I mean?
Right.
Never been one of those.
A couple things, man. First of all, R.I.P. to the chocolate Santa, this black dude from New Orleans that would go around taking pictures of the black Santa with all the people downside, you know, from New Orleans to Baton Rouge. Like, my kids took pictures with him. Like, my friends have taken pictures with him. I didn't, but, you know, I took pictures with the white Santa at Bon Marché Mall, Gar Charles, wherever they was at. But, but man, it's just weird. Like you said about the slavery thing, Malcolm X had a quote from one of his speeches that said, when they hang the rope around your neck, they pray to God and you pray to Jesus and they pray to Jesus. And he said, you wonder why Jesus don't come to help you. Well, you know, if we praying to the same people, and you are hanging me only because I'm black, and you know, treating me this way only because of the color of my skin, then that's just, it's simply hypocrisy, you know. And I wonder, you know, one of the things that made me question is, how can a person who owned slaves and did all of that just wait till they about to die and you ask for forgiveness and then they go to heaven? And then a person who lives righteous their entire life, you know, maybe not believe in Jesus or God or whatever, and then they got to go to hell. Like, I don't think that that's fair if you don't live your life the whole way. So that was something that troubled me when I was a kid growing up. Like, what? That doesn't make sense. I don't get that. But, you know, now I realize, you know, from my point of view, I just can't worry about, you know, what other people got going on. And I can only really focus on my character and my spirituality and my walk in my life and my journey and focus on that. And hopefully, you know, something that I do spreads to others. I leave my mark and make my mark on other people. And when my time, my clock is punched, you know, with things people say about me, you know, hopefully that they are positive. And that's all I can really control. I can't really control what happened, you know, then and now. I mean, you know, then, back then or whatever. So, you know, I know what I do, trying to help people, everybody, doesn't matter what race you are, you know, and that's just the society that we live in, unfortunately.
Hey, Zach. It does
matter, but I don't want it to.
So, that's Zach, great. My mom was saying that Jesus was Jewish, as you are. Right? So, but I'm just saying, like, it's funny because we're three dudes sitting here on a screen, right? Just three dudes sitting here on screen talking, but globally, at least, you know, nationally in America, Malcolm is considered black, I'm considered white, and you're considered Jewish. Like that's the labels they would place us. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Even though now my mom is full Italian. So does that mean I can call myself half Italian, half white? Because every time it says list your race, I just always put other, because it seems really stupid at this point to even like feed into that anymore. I mean,
I'd be like, I'm black, y'all, and I'm not, black, y'all.
You know what I'm saying? Okay, I'm just saying, like, not that I represent a race. I don't like how people represent a race. Like, do you feel like when someone says you're Jewish, what does that mean, I guess, to you? Because Jesus was Jewish. A lot of people forget that. You know what I mean? It's like, some people think Jesus was almost like an American dude or something, you know? Some people look at him like, just some dude. You know what I mean? Like if I grew my hair out, you know, they'd be like, he looks like Jesus.
Yeah, dude. I mean, I don't know. I want to take a step back real quick, though, when you talked about the founding fathers owning slaves. Okay. I have to keep on believing that. Like, I go back to Mark Green posted something, and I had a dream about it. I haven't shared it with him yet, so hopefully he watches this, but I'll share it with him. He said something about slavery is not a choice, but enslavement is. And, you know, a lot of that stuff got passed down to those people, right? So whether they were slave owners or they started it or they had slaves, whatever it is, I have to believe that when they signed the Constitution or whenever they tried to move forward, whether they had slaves or not, I feel like they were writing it for a better future. And that's what I have to believe. It's not that they were thinking like, yeah, we're just going to write this and just exclude black people. I have to, in my heart, believe that they were looking for a brighter future. So I wanted to just kind of say that note. We can talk about that later. But as far as the Jewish thing, like, what does it even mean that like Jesus is Jewish, right? Or what does it mean that I'm Jewish? It's just like this blood, this like bloodline of something that we've been told, right? And being Jewish is like a creed, and it's this feeling of, if you guys ever heard the word diaspora, and I don't think Trey has, but you know, within the black community as well, I think that the blacks and Jews can really learn a lot from each other, and we'll talk about that in a second. Is that, like, I don't know if Jesus cared that he was Jewish. I think the biggest point of it is that his people turned on him and decided, like, nah, bro, like, we're just gonna kill you. Like, we're turning you in because we know that you're this bright light and we just can't have that. Right. And I think that's the point of it. I mean, for me, here's what it means for me to be Jewish. My 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 great grandparents lived on the island of Rhodes, which is like a 45-minute plane ride from Israel. Mm-hmm. And this is how I'm tied in and able to play on Team Israel and be an Israeli American. And so they lived on the island of Rhodes, and they actually, my great grandparents spoke 5 different languages. And because before they were ruled by Turkey, Italy, Portugal, Spain, and Greece. And they're now Greece. And then they even came up with their own language. So they're called Sephardic Jews. And on the island of Rhodes, there was about 1,800 Jews on the island of Rhodes. And all of them got taken to Auschwitz. 200 returned. The rest of them died. But also before that, a big group of them decided, we're getting the hell out of here. And they made their way to California. So there's a big Sephardic movement in Southern California. And that's where my parents ended up. So both my great-grandfather's name is Reuben Israel. So his last name is Israel. And that's what it means for me, is it's like a culture, it's a traditional thing. And it's this connection to the diaspora around the world. And if you think of it, Hitler and the Nazis, they were trying to bury us, but they didn't realize that we were seeds. So now we're all around the world and we're like this power. And what we do now is we gather as a community, we support each other as a community. And I think this is one thing that I really would love for like everybody in the Black community to hear. And Reed, I'd love for you to hear this and also tell me what you think of it, is that one thing that Jews have done throughout all of time is they've never waited for somebody to apologize to them. They just continue to build, and then they go and make money, and then they build their communities. And I know Reed talked about this before, is that like the Black community has done this. The problem is that it just keeps getting destroyed. And then also another thing is that Jews throughout time have been able to hide behind their white skin, right? So like they've had a little bit of lighter skin. Black people can't hide behind any of that. So whether they're Jews, like you could be a Black Jew, it doesn't matter. You're Black. So, right. So like there's a little bit of like Jews have always found a way to hide, and almost like it's not the like shady people, but like they found a way to sneak around and still get the job done. But the thing is like what I just said is that like I feel like nowadays I do feel a sense that there should be an apology. But why are we going to wait for every single white person to apologize to every single Black person for the history of what's happened? Because I'm telling you, this is one thing that the Black community can learn, is that Jews, they never wait for an apology. They actually just go do better and then just say, hey, you know what? You guys try to fuck us, but you know what? We're actually cooler now. We're better than you guys. We actually own you guys now. And so there's a point there where it's like, if we continue to wait for an apology, if we continue to wait for every single white person to realize that there's white privilege or there's like, we have to apologize for our ancestors' wrongdoings, it's never going to be, we're never going to move forward, bro. And that's one thing that the Black community can take from the Jewish community. It's like, hey, dude, we don't need an apology. We're just going to go and build, and we're just going to be tight, and we're just going to be awesome. But there's also a sense, of brainwashing amongst not only the Blacks, but the Jewish community. It's just in a different sense. So we cannot wait, bro. Like Reed, my brothers, man, like my Black brothers, for real, like we can't wait for an apology. Not every single white person is ever going to apologize for slavery.
Right. No.
Or even for the shit that be happening like yesterday. You know what I'm saying? Like
it ain't gonna happen. Right? Like whatever happened yesterday.
You said a lot, you covered a lot, and you spoke on, you know, like how Black people have tried to just keep moving. Like you look at Black Wall Street, you know, which was in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1921, they dropped bombs on it. You know what I'm saying? These people had a self-sufficient community, and there have been, you know, that's existed all over the place in this country. And there's always ways that sometimes that they interact with white people and they work together, but it's the jealousy of a lot of white people who don't have you know, that aren't advancing, and then they see Black people advancing and they want to shut them, they want to shut them down because they feel like they're, it should be them. You know what I'm saying? And that's the problem. And, you know, Black people have created so much culture for the country of the United States. Like, we, you can't say that we ain't getting it in. You know what I'm saying? We doing our thing. We ain't really together like we could be. You know, I don't think so, at least. And we ain't getting the education that we could be as a whole. But we not a monolith. So it's like it's going to be like turds in every race. It's going to be good in every race. So it's going to be like, you can't blame all the bad things that happen for one race and superimpose that on everybody. Like, if I grew dreads out and or put gold teeth in my mouth, you know, I'm going to get in trouble because of something somebody else with gold teeth in their mouth did, or somebody else who sagged their pants. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to get profiled as the same person as them because of the way I look. I can't hide, like you said, I can't hide my Blackness. You know what I'm saying? And nothing I can do, I can get as educated and wealthy as I want, but it's not going to insulate me from racism and racial profiling.
No, same thing with Jewish, man. Everybody thinks I'm this stingy dude that's just like this Jewish whatever guy. That's just like, it's
right.
Like,
if you just say you're not Jewish no more, you know what I'm saying? You could just say, I'm a Christian now. You could convert. Totally. You could lie about that. No matter what I do, I'm Black.
Yeah.
And American. I'm stuck here. So I just got to deal with it and make it work, you know, for me.
Okay, Reed.
You got allies. Hold on, Buzz, before you say anything. And here's the thing. Like, the longer we wait, you got allies like me who are just sitting on the sidelines, just like waiting for some progress. But we can't help until there's somewhere to go. You know what I'm saying? Like, so like, there's so many people willing to help. But if we just keep waiting for this other random white dude to apologize or for him to admit something, and it's like, I'm a powerful dude. Like, let's do something, man. Like, and I'm not going to doing something is not trying to make my other white people feel, you know, shame them. That's not my gift. My gift is to build something and go move forward away from those people. You know what I'm saying?
No, I mean, I was just going to say, Reed, you'd mentioned about just Black people, I guess, having the ability to do certain things for the most part, whatever that may be, you know what I mean? And Zach was referring to kind of just taking things on your own, right? To make change and to do what needs to be done. But I think that's the large majority of our problems, especially here in America, is that whatever's happening in, like I've said this before, we're the United States, but everybody does their own thing individually. You know, everybody has their own set of laws that are different from, you know, there's a guy right now who is in jail for 10 years in Mississippi for something that if he was in California where Zach was from, he'd get a misdemeanor or whatever. And going back to my point of, you know, things changing, like the media tries to, I guess, portray what's happened, in my opinion, like with the Jacob Blake thing. Like, for some reason, I'm made to feel like that's happening in my neighborhood when it's not. Like, that's happening in my city when it's not. You know what I mean? Like that, you know, Black people are treated a certain way when I don't think they are, you know, and wherever you are in America. You know what I mean? There's so we try to people try to just worry about changing things or getting upset about things that really don't affect them like at all. They have no effect on their life whatsoever, but yet people are trying to invoke change through certain stuff that is not relevant to everyone. Like, focus on what's, you know, around you. You know, that's why, I mean, you know, look into your local politics and vote there first. You know, I mean, the people you vote for in your own city, in your own state, are going to have more impact on your day-to-day lifestyle and just freedoms than a president, and to a certain extent, you know what I mean? So why is it that, you know, am I wrong?
Let's talk about the local police, though. Like, growing up in predominantly white town, predominantly white cops, even Mexican cops, they profiled and they knew my car. they had pulled me over one time, and I had a buddy that had some weed in the car, and from then on, bro, it was just like every time they saw my car, pull me over and try to bust me for something, right? And so the profiling happens, and I think it's just like there's just too much power within that system. You know what I'm saying? So like,
no, Zach, I agree, the profiling, but Reed, going back to what Reed said about culture, you can't deny that there is such a strong impact of Black culture in our American society. And that's one of the things as a teenager growing up, if you displayed certain characteristics as a white kid growing up that were stereotyped as what Black kids do, then now mm-hmm. you're being stereotyped by the police. So even if you're a white kid who's portraying certain Black kid stereotypes, whether it's tinted windows or, you know, your car has rims on it or whatever. I mean,
I had a stereo system, actually.
You know what I'm saying? Right. If you got subwoofers, like, you're getting profiled based upon a, you know, predominantly Black culture thing. Am I wrong there, Reed?
Totally.
No, that's one. I see that all the time right around here. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, just like that night when you was hanging out with us, and they slapped the police slapped the root beer out your hand.
The IBC root beer out of my hand. And yeah, nobody else's. Yeah. It was like Black guys, you know, doing drugs in the parking lot. You know what I mean? Yeah. And
so you definitely got in that moment, and that stood out to you. And I look at it like this, like, you know, as far as what's going on in Wisconsin. Now, I'm not... The same thing be going on all over the place, but no. I don't. Yeah, bro.
What about Fargo, North Dakota, where Zach lived for years? What Zach? I mean, is that going on there?
The same, though? Because I mean,
when you have 99.9% white people in a place, how are you going to have any sort of racial tension there? Besides what you see on the news, so I mean, like, let's stop talking about this is America's problem. Like, it's. Wherever that's happening, that's your problem, man. I'm sorry, but that's your problem. You need to focus on it there. What can I do here in Mississippi? Seriously, what can I do in Mississippi to be helpful? I mean, I will. Trust me, I'll help, man. But I mean, like, if one of the rival schools I play is having trouble, you know, with getting equipment in or whatever, training their players, and we're ahead of them, I mean, is it my duty to go help them get better? You know what I mean? Not that we're competing with the states, but I'm just...
If it's Louisiana and Mississippi, we're not rivals. We like next door neighbors. You know
what I'm saying? Right, I'm just saying.
Next door neighbor, something going on at your house, then if that's going to affect the property value in your whole neighborhood. So you do need to like pay attention to it. And if there's something you can do directly, it will affect you. Not affect your personal life directly, but it does affect the future that your children might grow up in.
Think about
how it affects you personally, but what about the future that your children will? You know, how you gonna explain that to Josh when he's seeing, you know, white Black people getting killed all over and over again? You know,
No. I
think it's both sides, bro. I honestly think it's just the relationship, and it's just gotten so, the tension between cops and Black people is just so heated, bro. And I mean, honestly, like, if you watch, dude, I don't think anybody should have been shot 7 times. I don't think George Floyd should have had his knee on his neck for that long. But if you watch the whole videos, it's like, these dudes are worked up, man. Like, nobody wants to go to jail. You know, they're fighting for their life because nobody wants to go to jail, and they're feeling picked on. And yes, they're picked on. I get that. I totally get that. I don't know if you saw the whole video of Jacob Blake, but like, they were tasing him on the other side of the car, and he was just fighting, and he got up. I don't think they should have like shot him that many times, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the tension on both sides has gotten so high. And it's like to the point where like I encourage every single one of my Black friends, if they're willing to like go be a cop, hell yeah, go be a cop. I don't even know if it's going to make that much of a difference though, because the tension is so high. I don't know if you guys saw this, Colby Covington, he's a fighter, a boxer or something like that. He said this, like, don't say I agree with this or anything. I'm saying something that may not go well with a lot of people listening. Okay. What he said is like, He sarcastically said, he said, "Oh, wow, you postponed your games. Want to prove you're really about change? Quit your multi-million dollar jobs and soft privileges, live lives playing a kid's game, take a massive pay cut, and reform the toughest job in America, become cops." So, like, there's also that side of it where, like, people are just, like, over it. They're just like, okay, like, both sides are heated. Like, how can we actually get to a point where, like, cops aren't as scared of or of minorities and Black people, and especially Black people, and Black people aren't, like, just threatened and picked on by cops? Like, how do we get to that point? I don't know.
Yes.
But Trey, it's not just in Kenosha, bro. It's everywhere.
Yeah, for sure. But one thing I will say, Trey, like, I don't think if what happened in Minneapolis, Minnesota, I don't need to go march downtown Baton Rouge. I already said that I ain't really with going out there with the protests because it's so unorganized and nobody knows what the hell's going on. And then you don't know who's out there to do what.
And you got two kids and a wife at home. You know what I mean?
My seat because of something that happened in somewhere else. Now, when it happened here and everybody was pissed off and they was marching around, nobody really was burning or looting anything here in Baton Rouge. People went down and tried to have a peaceful march downtown, and like the police arrested everybody. They went and marched on Airline Highway. They had police everywhere, you know, like egging it on, making it worse than it had to be. And people wasn't really trying to do it like that from what I saw.
Can we work with what we got, though? Like, when we have a president, can we work with that guy? Or can we just, like, be like, no, we got to get him out and get that guy? And we're always looking for the next best thing. It's like, can we just work with what we got?
No. But again, that's why I think that everyone needs to, you know, really focus in. I mean, there's just a lot of people screaming about problems and talking about their pain. You know, I see a lot of these people on ESPN, which is to me become like the CNN of sports channels. But there's a lot of, it's very emotional. Like Scott Van Pelt looks depressed doing the Scott Van Pelt show because he's reporting that this coach apologizes for this statement. This coach apologizes for this statement. This player made remarks, and you know, it's sports have become. Sports have become so politically correct, like so politically correct. There was a, I think the owner of the coach of an MLS team, like he wanted to play his game the other day when all the teams, you know, walked off the court and no one played in America. But it was like, okay, so y'all weren't going to cancel your game, but because a basketball team did, now I'm going to. So you weren't – let me wind up. You weren't going to cancel your game, but since so-and-so is, you're like, well, we better cancel too. You know, and that's just the domino effect of the political, like, media pressure on people. And it's ridiculous that so many people get up in arms about it. Like, we can't do nothing from where we're sitting. We have no impact on what the NBA is doing or the boycotts. You know what I mean? It doesn't affect our pocketbooks or anything. But yet, it's like Zach said, are they really presenting solutions to all these problems using their platform and their money? Because the people that are most upset about it that you see on social media, what can they do about it besides, you know, make more of a divide amongst Black people and white people? Because that's ultimately what happens. Black people, white people get divided on the whole issue. You know what I mean? About cops and so what really can these NBA players do more, I guess, so to speak, you know, kind of like what Zach was saying, but
I talked about it already. So I'm gonna let Zach take that, you know, that response to what you just said.
I just hope there's more like Pat Tillman's, bro. Like, you remember Pat Tillman? He just gave up his whole football career and went and served in the army. Right. So like he went and like, served his country, and he felt that that's what he could do best rather than play football. You know, here's my biggest dude. I was pissed off when Mookie Betts signed that freaking huge deal. Like, for me, it's not even just Mookie Betts. It's like any person that signs a $35 million deal nowadays. Why do you need $35 million? How about you do this? Here's how you get the man. You sign for $20 million and then you say, hey, what? $15 million a year goes into this. This is where I want the money to go so it builds something better. Or
every time.
Or since baseball games and football games, everything's become so expensive. I doubt that when you have three kids, you can't even take your freaking kid to the game because it's so expensive now. Nope. How about this? How about this? Hey, my name's Zach Penprase. I'm not even going to take 20. I'm going to take $12 million for this year. And the other $25 million I was going to sign for is going to cut and actually allow underprivileged people to come to the games because I know that that's awesome. And it actually like serves like their heart and it makes them better people. And they have someone to look up to and they get some balls signed and they're able to see a game in person and they get to feel the atmosphere. Right. And so like, where is that action? So I don't even care. You don't have to quit your, you don't have to quit your career. Don't quit playing sports, but like there has to be something else done rather because why is a $35 million contract signed for generational money? Right. But if you're thinking about generational money, what does generational money create? Privilege. What are we all bitching about now? Privilege. So we just keep creating these problems like, oh, I don't have privilege. So now I'm going to do it. Now I have privilege. Now this person, now that, then they're just going to, and we just keep fighting for these privileges when really we ultimately, we all have certain privileges, bro. Yes, I have more privileges than you do. You have more privileges, whatever it is, dude. But like, can we do something different in these contract signings and these, like, what are, like, what? Come on.
Zach, I'm totally with you. I totally agree with that aspect of it because we both said it. If I ever made it to, honestly, you know, every college athlete has that one thought, you know, in their career, a lot of them that say, man, I make it go to the league doing this. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And then you start having those visions of, you'd be like, Jesus, if you let me make it, I'm going to give $1 million to my school. I'm going to give $1 million to my church. You know what I mean? Like that's really on your heart. And some of these athletes, they do give back, but I think exactly what, to your point, Zach, like money ultimately runs the show with a lot of things. And, you know, how do you make change is you put your money in it and you invest in the youth, the communities, which, you know, education is tied up in that, even local youth sports, whatnot. But, and add to your point about how expensive it is to go to a game, Zach. So if you want to go to a college football game in Mississippi State, right? You're paying $200 for me and my wife and two kids. We're going to spend $200 on tickets, $50 on food, you know, and $25 for parking. I'm just saying average. We're spending $300 to go watch a football game. So then it becomes a, you know, the rich get richer, you know, type thing. But you're right, man. It's professional sports, especially, have gotten ridiculous. I mean, you go to a Saints game and get some nasty $15 shrimp and fry basket, you know, that salty and whatnot. But I think what you're saying is right, man.
I want to say this, like the owners are the ones who raising these prices on these tickets. And the players, I think it's fair for the players because they got to get their fair share of the revenue. If the people who want, you know, I love to go see my Raiders play. You know, I went to see the Indians play in Houston.
How much? How much did it cost you? As a teacher, as a reminder, Reed is a teacher.
Reed is a teacher. Fly to these places.
The one time that I actually went, I took my wife and my two kids to the Raiders and Texans game last football season. I spent about $300 on tickets.
I'm just saying that was what that was.
But I'm thinking this the point that I'm making is these owners are raising these ticket prices so much, and your average Joe can't even afford to enjoy, you know, the real hardcore fans can't even afford to go to the games. I looked at these Lakers, that mean these Raiders versus Saints game in Vegas, opening home opener in Vegas, right? The tickets are like $1,000 on the low end, bro. Like $800, $700. It's no way. You know what I'm saying? There's no way that you know that that's a wise financial decision for me. So these players are looking at it from the aspect like I'm getting, they making all this money on these tickets. I gotta get my fair share. And it's only right that they do, honestly, that these owners gotta compensate them, because if everybody wanna go see Mookie Betts and they paying $500 for a ticket to go see Mookie Betts, Mookie Betts gotta get at least 200 of that ticket. You know what I'm saying? The owner gonna get the owner gonna make the lion's share of it, but he deserve his thing. And the owners should be giving back, and the owners and the players should be working together to make it accessible for the hardcore fans who can't afford it. You know, they should have camps in place, summer camps, I don't know, some kind of thing in place that these owners do to really show appreciation to the people who are tuning in and giving these teams these ratings, because they can't afford to go pay. And some people breaking themselves to go to these games, man. I ain't gonna do it. But they like, you know, going broke trying to buy tickets, because like Zach said, it's good for their mentals. It's good for their spirit. It makes them feel like they're a part of it, and they get to see someone who they admire and inspire. But
it makes them alive. It
moms and dads are going broke, you know what I'm saying, to take their kids to these games just so their kid can have that experience. So, you know, I think the players are right by getting the money that they're getting, but something needs to happen to where more things are put in place for those people to, you know, to give back. And I don't know what people are doing to give back personally with their money, but we should see more of it, you know.
I mean, and so you can imagine Lionel Messi, Reed, he makes like almost $1 million per game that he plays in. You understand? Like a week, like $1 million a week, I think is what his salary is. So, I mean, he could create his own school system in Mississippi. You know what I'm saying? I'm just saying, but again, shout out to Brett Baer, Malcolm. Brett said, Brett made it to the league, you know, played with the Rams and whatnot. I think he's a successful, doctor now.
Do y'all know who one of the top paid athletes is? He's a black dude, European black dude. Makes about $50 million a year.
Are you talking about soccer player?
No.
No?
Baseball?
Nope.
Nope.
You guys probably don't even think it's a sport, actually.
Cricket? Are you talking about cricket?
Nope.
I don't know what it is.
Formula One driver, bro. Lewis Hamilton.
Oh. Wow.
Where's he from?
Like Great Britain or something like that. Like some English country. But.
No, yeah. I mean.
The UK. The UK.
I'm just.
Huh? The UK.
I'm just saying. Okay, Reed, back to what Brett was saying. He was talking about it shouldn't be just like a one-time event for someone to go to a professional game or college game. You know what I mean? Right. Like, you should be able to take your family and kids to go enjoy and be in that atmosphere. But during COVID, I mean, people are trying to take those freedoms away because we're somehow endangering everyone by, you know, carrying on with society. You know what I'm saying?
I don't even want to get into the conspiracy of COVID, do you?
Too much. We'll be here to midnight.
But Zach,
I have my theories, but I try to just, because it's just
That's one of my biggest issues too. Is the oppression part? Is that like, bro? Like minorities, black people need better food, bro. Like we need to provide everybody with better food. This helps mental state, physical state. This helps people perform better. It helps people work better, work harder, have ideas for businesses. But we just say, put a mask on. You're gonna be okay. Well, right. Okay. Like, what? But how can I get better though? What can I do to like actually better myself?
Right.
Well, man, Zach, you know what?
He just died from colon cancer. I wonder what his diet was like. And he had, you know, money and resources, I guess, to be eating right or whatever. I don't know what, you know, I'm not trying to make assumptions about the guy, but you know, if we are all exposed to different type of diseases and things based off our nutrition, and then it's passed down generationally, you know, who knows what the situation is. But I know specifically that North Baton Rouge, like, we don't have no good grocery stores in North Baton Rouge. South Baton Rouge either, old South Baton Rouge, well, you know, the black neighborhood. Like, pretty much all of the majority of black neighborhoods in Baton Rouge have, like, no real nutrition place.
Yeah. Like fresh.
You're being poisoned, bro.
People in the community, shout out to them who are trying to, you know, put these things in place and have, like, farmers markets and
right, farmers markets are a big thing.
He just like started his own little farm that he got going on. So JB, my boy Jaziri Basile, you know, I'm naming some guys who I know for a fact is doing the farmers market thing and trying to do, you know, the agricultural thing and bring food into the communities. But you know,
it also has to do with education though, Reed. Like understanding that like black people's diet is going to be different than white people's diet, bro. Like, your guys' hemoglobin is different. Like, your blood cells are different. Like, so educating actually, like, first of all, you're getting poisoned. Second of all, like, my diet is going to be to my body, not to Reed's body, not to Butts's body, not to other white people's body, but to my body, and educating that, right? And so, like, we kill these people who actually have Dr. Sebi, bro. Like, we just killed Dr. Sebi, and he just has all this massive information, and most people don't even know about Dr. Sebi. Most people are just in denial of the fact that we're all different, that we have different ways. Our bodies work different. Our bodies are all different systems. So, like, yeah, shout out to your boys for doing their part. And then also it's helping people learn their bodies better too. So the education part is very huge as well on that.
That's, well, like with the food, yeah.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
I'm just saying with the, Malcolm, you're talking about like the fresh markets with the food and whatnot. Statistically, black people are dying from COVID, I think, at a more higher rate than white people. Not that more have died, I guess, but percentage wise, you know, like per capita, you know, because of pre-existing conditions, which are mostly caused from, you know, poor eating habits and whatnot. But then again, that goes back to what's in their neighborhood, what's available, what's being offered to them. Do they have fresh market grocery stores? You know, do they have really horrible fast food restaurants? And gas stations serving out, you know, fried chicken made from God knows where in the back. But Zach, you're right. The education part, it's also parents teaching their kids about a good, healthy diet. And you're talking about funding in the schools. You're talking about funding in the schools. Let me tell you something. Why? Like you go to a private school. Look, my private school, I went to high school. We had every type of food you can imagine that was very healthy choices. You know what I mean? The most healthiest choices you're going to have. Public school, for the most part, what my kids eat here is the same as what Reed's kids are eating. You know what I'm saying? And it's, I mean, we should dump a lot more money into just ours. If we did just that within our public schools, imagine what that would do. The eating habits that children would create from the time they start kindergarten to the time they leave, you know, it's one of those things where we offer them more. We kind of, you know, imply it, but some schools, man, serve a lot of fried chicken tenders and you know, processed burgers and, you know what I mean?
It's all the habits, bro. It's, you know, all the habits. Just, I'll give you guys another golden. Can I just say one conspiracy on COVID real quick and then I'll get on to it?
Of course.
Did you know that they put a strain of HIV in COVID so it can mutate from person to person over time, just like AIDS? So that's what who does AIDS mostly attack?
I ain't been the knowledge on that, but I'm
okay. So that's just the conspiracy. You guys can do your research on that. Okay. Not every conspiracy is a theory, by the way. There's a lot of truth, but I think it's all the habits too. Like, dude, I get worried, bro, because my homies are being brainwashed. I've been brainwashed for a while. Like, think about it. Think about everybody that wants to go and get the new Jordans, and they're told to make money to get these new shoes. And then the very next second, they're told that if you have money, you're evil.
the Bible says that it's harder for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to get into heaven. That's what the Bible does say.
The message of being rich is the misinterpretation, though.
Uh-huh.
It's not it. So we deliver the message of being rich as something with money that you can do whatever. What is actually being rich? Is it being rich to be able to buy a bunch of shoes? Or is it being rich so you can just only work a couple hours a day and hang out with your family? What is being rich? So like when we misinterpret every single message, yeah, of course nobody's religious anymore because religion's been so misinterpreted. Yeah, of course. Like, why would we believe in that shit?
Right.
So we're
going back to the
That's the thing. Like, if you got a good spiritual leader and a good guide and somebody who can do a good job of interpreting or saying, informing you that, hey, this might be misinterpreted. You got to look deeper into it. Then maybe that'll help people understand in a different way. But if that's not there and there's no kind of foundation on that and you're just looking at it, this is just hypocrisy. This is just contradiction. Let's get it. Leave that alone. That's crazy.
We need leaders like you guys. We got to lead from within. We can't wait for this singular leader to become president or become mayor. We have leaders from within like you guys. You guys are in with the students. You guys are in with the youngsters and teaching them your perspective and your knowledge and every, gathering the conspiracies and filtering through your filters. But I feel like they broke our filters, and so a lot of us can't even filter the stuff. So we don't even really know what's true anymore either.
That's the problem. It's either I think Denzel Washington said it best. He's like, we're either uninformed or misinformed. You know what I mean? And that's one reason. Like I was telling you earlier, I just don't really follow the news. I look at the radar if I need to. You know what I mean? I may look at some I watch a lot of soccer. I may look at some ESPN scores. I dabble on Facebook, but mostly I enjoy seeing my friends and their kids. And I enjoy seeing Malcolm's kid hit the tee ball off the bat and run, you know what I mean, when he's 4 years old. Like, but so many people focus on the wrong things just entirely. And
what you feed will grow, bro. You feed that negativity, you're just gonna
exactly. And people just buy into it, you know what I mean? People buy into the thought of something negative and awful and they run with it and they let it just overtake them. And you see a lot of that happening now. There's the stuff that's happened is just, it's spread so much hate. And we're kind of on the anniversary. Reed, what are we on the anniversary of? I'll let you tell it. What are we just at the anniversary of?
Yesterday it was like a threefold, and we got Yasmin in here. You know what I'm saying?
Dude.
And we probably gonna have to get you in here.
Yeah, shout out to Yaz, bro. You got to get her perspective for sure.
I know you got some stuff, and we actually had some conversations, and this is a lot for us to get to. But the three things that that historically were significant on yesterday were one, the anniversary of the Emmett Till murder that took place. And I did a lot of research on that. And we went to, there's a whole exhibit on that in the Civil Rights Museum in Jackson. We didn't really get to spend too much time there when we went, but Emmett Till is something I learned about like my senior year in high school. I didn't, I never knew about it. And that was one biggest sparks of the civil rights movement, because his mom was like, no, leave the casket open so they can see how they had destroyed this 14-year-old boy's face. And it's grown men that did it. One of the dudes was 36 years old. I'm 36. Trey, you 36. Zach, you what, 35?
35, yeah. I cried the first time I saw a picture of Emmett Till, bro.
Imagine one of us, or you two guys, y'all two, being the white guys who was in Mississippi, going to LaFleur High, pulling a freshman out of class and going murder him. You know what I'm saying? That's what Emmett Till was like. And right there in the Delta. Anyway, moving forward, the next thing that was very significant on August 28, 1963, was the March on Washington that Martin Luther King had his famous I Have a Dream speech, which Trey had a poster of in his wall in his apartment at one point. And he gave me that poster. I put it on the wall in my house. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to Trey for having it. You know what I'm saying? That was
another thing we could. I was like, how can I fit in here at HBCU? I'm gonna get a Martin Luther King poster and hang it up in my apartment.
Oh my gosh, dude.
It made me like, oh, just like I told you what the DM you had in your room.
The crazy sorry. I actually had that in my room in high school though. So that wasn't something that I bought. Like, I'm just joking. Like, anyway, go ahead.
But the third thing was the significance of the baseball MLB. Which usually does it earlier in April when Jackie Robinson had his first game, but they decided to do it yesterday for this season. And then it just so happened that, you know, Chadwick Boseman passed away on that day and he played Jackie Robinson. So yesterday was just like a lot going on.
But it's weird how
historically
what's
significant.
Happening now, right?
Right,
so
right.
And what's happened now?
Yeah, it's all connected to everything that's going on right now. So, you know, that's just something that I thought we should definitely highlight.
Okay, but Reed, are people marching on Washington now, though? What were black people white
yesterday
people?
Yesterday they did. They did. They marched.
Okay, Zach, we were talking about this last week. The significance of what black people are fighting for now as compared to what was the anniversary, Reed? How many years ago? The March of Washington? Was that 60?
47.
47? Six. How many years? So, 57, Reed?
Yeah.
Okay. So 63 years ago, I don't really have the knowledge to speak on it, but the significance that would be like, your grandparents marching on Washington,
mm-hmm, right? My parents too.
As compared to the generations of today, most of them are our age. They're right. I mean, it's the black people generation, I guess, much younger. Mostly, maybe. I'm not really sure. Is it okay? So, but the significance of it, like, is one greater than the other, or is it just in the era of how media is, it's portrayed as more significant, or is it equal in a sense? You know what I mean?
I'll say this. First of all, with what happened yesterday with Chadwick Boseman dying and him playing Jackie Robinson and the coincidence, I'll tell you guys this. Coincidence is God's way of staying anonymous. So when you think of it like that, it all makes sense, bro. It all makes sense.
I like that.
It's just stuff that has to line up. So everybody just is like, whoa, what the hell, right? But right. I think with the how far we've come, we keep playing into this and keep feeding the fact that, like, we're still stuck in back in the day. First of all, I totally disagree with that, because I literally cried the first time I saw Emmett Till's a picture of Emmett Till and that gruesome beating. And I'm sure back in that day, there was many people who were like, yeah, who you know, kill that dude. But I'm sure that there's probably about 98% of people nowadays that are like, that shit is wrong.
Right.
And I'm sure pretty much about 99.9% of people that saw the George Floyd video were like disgusted. It doesn't matter if you're what side you're on, what color you on, everyone was disgusted with that. And then the way that they dragged him onto the stretcher and they just treat, like, it was just the inhumanity of the whole thing. Everyone was disgusted. And people that haven't even seen the video are be like, nah, I can't watch it because I know it's bad. So I think that, like, we can't keep repeating this narrative like, oh, well, we're still fighting for the same thing. Like, there is maybe one thing that we're still fighting for is the fact that, like, at some point we still have something in us that's like, I'm scared of that big black dude over there. But that's only a very small percentage of people, dude. Like, I really think it's weird when there's a white person. First of all, I've gone to the projects and spent weekends in, like, have you guys ever been to Marks, Mississippi? I went to spend a weekend with my boy Thaddeus Sachs, bro, T-Sachs. I went to the projects. We went to, it was all black city, all black clubs. everything. I just jumped into the culture, bro. So like I just jumped in, and I always spent weekends with Pat from the cafeteria. I would always go and play dominoes in the hood and just, you know, experience that. So like I just feel like when I have these people from, and some of these people are gonna watch this, some of my friends from high school or whatever, that have never even actually experienced what I've experienced, and they're gonna try to shame me into saying, well, you don't get it. You are those people that are blah, 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 blah. It's like, no, I'm not those people. I'm actually not. Not many people are. So the fact that you're sitting here shaming me is really causing more of an issue. You're separating me from like some of my really, really good friends who I would die for. Are you willing to die for them? I've told a story where, like, when it comes down to it, are you going to stand up? Like, actually stand in front of somebody. Are you gonna stand behind somebody? Am I gonna stand behind Reed and go, yeah, dude, his life matters? Or am I gonna stand in front of him and be like, yo, this dude's life matters, I'm gonna stand in front of him because it matters so much? So what's actually gonna happen in that moment, as opposed to what the hell you do online? I don't care what you do online. I care what you do in that moment when somebody says something. Are you gonna stand in front, or are you gonna stand from behind and start yelling shit?
Yeah, I agree with you, man. I kind of got lost in it. I mean,
in fire, bro. In the cap. That's real.
it really is, Zach, because the label is placed on people. You know what I mean? But I don't put that label on Reed, just like I don't on you. And your parents didn't teach you that. There's so many. As from my perspective, Reed, disagree if you want to. From what my perspective, I'm more upset. It's hard to say you're upset about someone dying, but I'm more upset about situations like Ahmaud Arbery, where he was literally hunted down by civilians and killed because he was a black guy who they thought was robbing them or trying to rob or own their property, like civilians, right? Because those civilians that killed Ahmaud Arbery, they have been bred hate into their life from the beginning. No one's taught them different. And somehow I feel like that America tries to tie in a white cop with the same type of, is the same type of person, if that makes sense. Like there's two sides of it.
Some of them are the same person.
They most certainly are. They most certainly are. But I just feel like because it's a, why is it that it's, if it's a cop that does it, you know, there are people, the cops are supposed to be protecting us. You know what I mean? They're supposed to be protecting us. And I guess that's why there's a, like you're talking about a fear there, but I think it's just as much of an issue that there's people in this world without a badge that don't have the right to stop someone or for doing wrong, so to speak, that are just willing to seek out those people. And they have real malice in their heart to do harm to them because they are black. Not, you know what I mean? And I think that's just a fine line there, Reed. You know what I mean?
Wait, let me say this, because I do kind of disagree, because the guy who killed Ahmaud Arbery worked as a cop.
He was a former cop, right? He was a former sheriff, right?
It don't matter during his time as a cop. You know what I'm saying?
That's funny, Zach, for some reason.
Look, think about it like
this. I wasn't going to say it. I knew Reed was.
No. I'm just talking about the situation. I'm just talking about how the, I'm just talking about the media reporting it. The media reporting it. Why is one life greater than the other? You know what I'm saying? Okay, but they try to make it out to be that way.
I think George Zimmerman would have been a better example for what the point you're trying to make about, like, vigilante racism that ends in murder. But the police have been doing it for years, and they get justified. And before these things got on tape, you know what I'm saying? Even in that case, you can see a million different, like, I think I sent you another video of the dude who was, like, going back in his car. I've seen two videos now of a white dude going back in his car you know, with the police standing there with the gun drawn and they didn't shoot. You know what I'm saying? It's just a different thing. And when the cops are doing it, like Tamir Rice was a 12-year-old kid in the park playing with a toy gun. The police roll up on him and kill this kid who's 12. You know what
I'm
saying?
He was pointing a gun at the...
I was a white kid. Right. I just can't see it. You know what I'm saying? We don't,
no, I don't get know it. For sure,
but it's just way less likely. And that's in every instance. So, you know, we can't separate. I would love to be able to say the cops, you know, are different than these random civilians who go vigilante mode. But unfortunately, a lot of, you know, and I'm gonna quote Malcolm X again, a lot of the police have turned in those sheets. You know what I'm saying? Well, some of them have turned in the sheets for badges. You know what I'm saying? So we saw the presence of the Klan grow. You know, we saw all that history at that museum. And think about how many of those guys ended up being cops.
Of course. I'm not denying that
the cops who are out there right now are Klansmen, but they might have been raised by Klansmen, or they might have been raised by Klan friends of Klansmen or Klan sympathizers or whatever the case may be. And you could see in that dude who stood on George Floyd's neck, who took an oath to serve and protect civilians in his city, not care. You could see it in his face. You could see his body language that he had the intent to kill a man who he didn't have to kill, that the man who he swore to protect and serve. You know what I'm saying? As a civilian of that city. So as a citizen of that city. So, you know, I wish there could be a line drawn. I really do. But there can't be until, you know, cops are at least held accountable in these instances, because when cops kill white dudes, they usually don't really get the same, you know, administrative leave, no grand jury indictment, no trial, none of that. I'm not 100% certain on that, so don't quote me, but I do feel like that there's clearly a discrepancy, and most people who see it agree with it. Some people don't, and they try to justify it, and I just don't agree with that.
So what if they, and Reed, I agree with you, man. And I guess my point is mainly based from a media perspective side of it, like what they try to, you know, enforce on the public to say, well, this is how you should feel about it, and this is what needs to make you most upset. I guess what bothers me is the, you know, yeah, of course, cops, you know, I think that's a, trying to keep cops from killing people that they're having confrontations with, I think that's an easier fix, more so than the vigilantes that are, you know, looking for Ahmaud Arbery running down the street, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, at the same time, Reed, to your point, a lot of people were just totally amazed at how the white kid, the 17-year-old that, you know, shot a few people at the rally, was literally running towards police with a weapon after he had already fired it. And like armored trucks were driving by, other police cars were like, hey man, what's going on? Like, how did that even transpire to that point? You know what I'm saying? But, and okay, Reed, would this fix the problem? Would this fix the problem, right? I'm gonna quote Eminem. You quote Malcolm X, right? Right, you ready for this, Zach? Right? So stop sending white cops into black neighborhoods that have never had any experiences with black people or black culture ever. All they know is what they see on TV or hearing music. Would that help, Reed? Would that help?
Yes, of course.
Like if me and Zach were cops, like, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like I would have a different perspective.
I wouldn't be able to do that, bro. I'd be in there smoking blunts and drinking Crown with them, bro. Like it just wouldn't. I wouldn't be able to do that, dude. Like
you would be a dirty cop. You'd be a dirty cop.
No,
you wouldn't be a racist.
I didn't say I'm really slinging it.
You wouldn't be a racist. You wouldn't be a. I'd rather you be a dirty cop than a racist cop. You know what I'm saying?
For sure.
But if you're a dirty, racist cop. Like the ones me and Malcolm saw when we were freshmen.
Then what do you mean, like Denzel on Training Day? He was a dirty racist cop too.
No, Zach. The state trooper that me and Reed saw with three Klansmen in the back seat, that's a dirty racist cop.
Bro, where was the Eminem quote, by the way? And don't ever again compare Eminem to Malcolm X. Don't ever.
I didn't do that. I didn't compare that. Zach, real quick, Zach needs a reference.
I would love to just hear like Reed to just roll off Malcolm X quotes, because I love Malcolm X just as much as Malcolm does.
Okay. I respect. I'm just saying that's Zach, that was on the Relapse album that he made, the song about, it was called, Superstar. And he was talking about how like white police officers have this privilege. Like he was saying it, you know what I mean? Like basically what's happening now, a lot of rappers have said it, but anyway.
Paraphrase.
So Reed, that would help though, Reed? Would that help? I mean, I've heard people jokingly talk about. Well, what if we just said black cops?
They don't even have to be racist.
Go ahead, Zach. Go ahead. I was gonna say
they don't have to. They don't have to like know the culture. They just don't have to be like traumatized young white dudes that have no idea what the heck's going on, that hate everything about the culture. You know, it's just, and they're just always scared. No matter, like, as soon as the call happens, it's like, okay. Like it's
the stereotyping begins. The stereotyping begins.
Gotta say though.
So look, this
stereotyping.
If they grow up listening to rap music, and thinking about all the things that like the hardcore hip hop gangster rap or whatever, so they think they know what a gangster looks like. You know what I'm saying? Based off that, they think they know off the videos. They think they really understand. So. So that's a white cop who grows up listening to gangster rap and becomes a cop, right? A black kid who not really a gangster, you know what I'm saying? Two-parent household, good home, all that good stuff. And they into the gangster rap too. So they not really gangsters, but they dress like it, they look like it, they talk like it, they feeling it. That white cop is going to look at that fake gangster and might end up in a confrontation with him because of that. So that... If he's trying to connect with the culture and he think he has a connection through it, through the media, through the music, through that, and he really don't understand that everybody not the same. So, you know, I think that if it's a person who actually like grew up in the neighborhood and hung out with black people and went in some houses and spent some time on Sunday eating soul food, you know, and sitting down at the kitchen table, kicking it with some people and going to the football games with a band playing, and you know what I'm saying, all of that, they might have a different appreciation and respect for what the culture is because they understand it better from a first-hand point of view. Not what rappers say, not what TV say, but like what they see with their own eyes and what they've experienced. So,
but it's not, but
of course you have a connection with the community, because think about it. White people who police white communities don't really be having them problems. They already know each other. It's all good. They see each other. They slap five. They be at the football games. It's all good. If they pull you away, man, you know, what you doing out here? Where your mom at? Let me call them and tell them I got you, but I'm going to send you home. If they don't know people, man, I don't care about your people. You going to jail with me. You know what I'm saying? And that's that. So, yes.
But I'm talking about the other side of it, Reed. But people are not just upset at that, right? I feel like that... The two white cops that rolled up to the domestic violence situation with the Brooks guy, right, in Wisconsin. Blake. Okay, so let's be honest. We don't know those cops personally, but like Zach's talking about, you know, going to the projects, whatever. If those cops had never been to those apartment complexes, but other than just police calls, right, then that's their only perception of that place. Not that there's really good people that live in there or really good kids or smart kids, but I get called, this is where the thugs are, you know what I mean? So they approach that already like, you know, this is how they are. Not knowing that even though the hardest, you know, criminal in the world still has a human decency side besides the really, you know, crazy one. That's one side of it, but I think the one thing that most people are still continue to get upset, like black people read, is how the white kid that walked down the street with the rifle and nobody even pulled a gun on him. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah.
As compared, Zach, have you seen that?
What about he didn't have a gun in his hand. His hands were up like this, but
I mean, he had it originally, you know what I'm saying?
I'm not agreeing with that whole situation. Just jacked up.
Right. Ain't nobody
now right. Trying to justify, everyone's trying to justify both sides. And it's just like, he got thrown Molotov cocktail at himself. And it's just like, it's just so much. It's all distraction.
It is, but at
the same time though, what about like the trigger points? Like a lot of white people only hear, like, in rap music, it's like fuck the police. So like, if you become a cop and like that, you've heard songs with like that, then like, mm-hmm. of course you're going to be triggered when you show up and that person's playing a rap song. You're like, oh, this dude instantly doesn't like me.
Right.
And then
there's tension on both sides.
Like, well, this dude instantly doesn't like me because like I'm black. And so it's just like, it's just a heightened situation to begin with, bro. Like, it's just trigger points all over the place.
It is.
So, like, here's an actual solution that I know that's happening, is what's called the Police Protective League. And I coach a kid, his dad's name is Rob Harris. And he actually puts on events where cops go and like play basketball with like inner city blacks, like older blacks, and like ex-criminals, and like actually bringing and doing what you're saying, Reed, is like experience the culture and having, you know, sitting down and having food, playing a basketball game or playing baseball game, whatever it is. And it's cops and it's minorities, it's inner city people. And so it's the Police Protective League in a sense that like, it's making the relationship better. So then that way these cops aren't always heightened. And then the other side's not always heightened as well. So there is actually things like that being done. But it's also at the same time being so almost canceled, because it's like, nah, dude, like, we don't need police. We're going to defund them. Like, you know, fuck those guys. That's it. And so even those little programs are having trouble getting traction. So there is things that can be done, you know, bring people together and create a community. But I don't know, man. I mean, I really don't know. Nobody has an answer right now.
No, I don't have all the answers. I mean, I'm not gonna ever pretend like I have all the answers, but just figure things out and make society work for me, you know what I'm saying? And for everybody who I can help build it on. So one thing that's, since, you know, you talked about defending the police, Yaz is asking about that, and I think we could, you know, talk about, you know, defunding the police. I don't really know exactly what that means specifically, because
I'll tell you what it means. I'll tell you what it means. Like,
you know, cancel the police. And
I know it's again, it's, they're using a phrase that is very misleading, because the people that want to defund the police, they want to take away certain things like military type equipment. You know, they're saying, let's not spend money on armor, tanks and whatnot.
Sure.
I'm the opposite. I feel like if something was to go down, you may need that one armor tank. You know, if something was to happen severe in your city, in your hometown, Reed, where every now and then some crazy dude is gonna, you know, pop off. You know what I mean? You may need some heavy artillery. You remember when we was in college, Reed, playing football, and we were on the way to Alabama A&M, and we were on high alert because there was an active shooter. Remember the guy that him and his son were traveling the country shooting random people at random times?
He was and one like, of them was from Baton Rouge.
Okay, so, but where we were going from Itabena to Huntsville, we were in an area that like was close proximity to like his last known shooting or whatever, right? So defunding the police, you know, some people think, well, imagine if we didn't have state troopers to go with us on every single away trip, you know what I mean, in college football. So like our police officers were on heavy alert. I mean, they were getting us in and out of places like the Secret Service and things like that, you know what I mean? But I mean, what
if there's an idea. Here's an idea. Okay. So with Rayshard Brooks, right?
Yeah.
So first of all, I'm in Canada, and there's a street right here down Niagawa. Reed, that's your favorite street, Niagawa. And there's a cop sitting in the middle, bro. Like, why are cops sitting there giving out tickets? No, I don't care if you need to make money. No, just go home and just don't work for that those 2 hours, bro. Like, seriously, like, we don't need you to give out tickets. So stop that. Let's spend that money with Rayshard Brooks. This guy was drunk. Let's bring in somebody that said that comes in and says, hey, Rayshard, is this like a regular occurrence? Do you think you have an alcohol problem? Or can we just take you home tonight and you can come pick up your car tomorrow and we'll give you $100 fine or a couple $100 fine for whatever. Or you'll get a right. You'll get a DUI misdemeanor where you so or you say like, hey, do you feel you have an issue with alcohol? No. All right, we'll take you home. Okay, you think you do? Let's get you an AA program and you'll have to go for the next 3 months. You have to go to AA and then you report back to whoever. So that's an idea that we can use instead of defunding the police. Oh, we just take the money and spend it somewhere else. Also in Winnipeg, in Winnipeg, Canada, what they did with these like homeless people that had needles in their arm, they were Native Americans, actually, most of them. And they were addicted to drugs. They were on the street, passed out. They spent money on a cleanup crew that was like the Garda. They call them the Garda. And they would go pick these people up, bring them to a shelter, clean them up, get them some nutrition. And they would actually help them get back on their feet instead of just throwing them in jail. And that's it. So there's a couple ideas that we could do.
No, I mean, it's, you're exactly right. Mental health, like helping their mental health, right?
What do you got, Reed?
I think it's about, Trey was saying about, you know, armored tanks. We definitely need to demilitarize the police. So Zach talked about reallocating to different things, and I'm definitely, like, a supporter of demilitarizing. Because, look, Trey, you saying we need armored tanks?
I'm just saying, like, maybe one, you know what I mean?
At least, all right, that's cool. There's a huge National Guard thing right here. Mm-hmm. Why? We spend more money on our military than literally every other thing combined. We spend more money on our military federally than some countries' gross national product, a lot of them, actually. So we don't really need to spend more money on local policing when we already got funding from the top down. And if there's a serious situation, then we call the National Guard and let the feds handle it. We don't have to spend our local police. We already been talking about education and lack of funding there. If we spending more money on the military than education, then we got priority problems. Seriously. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I've been teaching civics for a long time now, and I look at the national budget every year, and I bring it to the students and show them the stats. Why do we need to be the country that spends more money on defense than anybody else? Ain't nobody coming to attack us. We good. We got everything we need for anybody who even think about it anyway. They gonna lose. Any country that go to war with the United States is gonna lose. So we don't need no more money spent on it. We could cap right there where we got it at and start. We don't need to like, it don't, the amount of spending on police funding and all that don't need to go up no more. And education needs a lot more. You know what I mean? Healthcare needs to go up a lot more. Where are our priorities? Building people, keeping them healthy. You know what I'm saying? And educating them and getting their knowledge right. If our priority is fighting and not building, then it's only a matter of time before that ain't gonna work no more.
But bro, Wakanda had some sick ass military too, bro.
Yeah, hold up, right, y'all starting on Wakanda again. Reed, real quick about the defunding the police. It's there's so much, like, you're saying one thing, but you're asking for another. When you say you want to defund the police because they're poorly trained, doesn't that seem like that's the total opposite? Let's put more let's make sure we train these guys. Almost right. Militaristic style. Why don't we train our police officers like they do the Navy SEALs?
Demilitarize. And yeah, you can reallocate training.
I'm just saying from the perspective of if they're trying to get if you don't want the shooting to happen in Wisconsin, right? When you shoot someone 7 times in the back like that, first off, if you're properly trained, you don't let him get away from you and get to that side of the vehicle first. You detain him. I mean, you both y'all know how many cops. How many cops you know that are out of shape? How many cops you know that are not fit, that are not coordinated, right? Or that are so old, you know, they don't have the, you know, ability to even physically, you know, do things. The point I'm trying to make is that if we put more funding into police training and continued training of, you know, instead of shooting a guy seven times, couldn't you shoot him?
I don't think better training necessarily costs more money.
Well, it's like Malcolm says, divert it from, you know, the military to police, which is ultimately the lowest form of military, right? I mean,
outsourcing the training, I'm gonna say this right quick, outsourcing the training into other kind of different things, not just the physical training part, but the mental aspect, the community aspect, the relating to other people, you know, getting funding different type of programs for the police who, if you are a policeman in a certain area of the city, find a way for the police to have some kind of interaction with these people that is positive, not just responding to calls, but like going in and actually meeting up, maybe going to the park and having family day in the park with the police. You know what I'm saying? A barbecue, a cookout. I don't know. You know
what
I mean?
Well, that's why police officers are so important in schools, right? Zach, did y'all have them in California? You know, like the, you have the police officers that basically are inside the school district. I mean, inside the school buildings at all time. You know what I mean? The games. Really?
Really? Private school.
I mean,
the cop that was on the cop that was on campus was for people that were on probation, homie.
We have cops in our school. They're at all the games. They're at everything. So they're well known in the community. They're known in the community. You know what I mean? They know what car everyone drives that lives in Ridgeland. They know what car the kids drive that go to school. You know what I mean? So, you know, maybe
that's a double edge. I think with the
cops. Yeah.
It could be good and it could be really bad.
Then how does racism still exist so much in the South?
Our two cops at our school are one of them's mixed and one of them's black.
It doesn't matter. It like we don't even have to talk about white or black racism. It's just the fact that the relationship is not good.
There's tension. It's tension. There's tension there for sure.
So and I really don't think that like more training, I don't think better training has to cost more money. I honestly don't. Like, maybe just get people in there that care.
Well, Zach, I mean,
that aren't just trying to get like their pension, bro, and just
exactly. Hey, when I retire, I'm gonna get paid Zach, the next years. Zach, it's the same with teachers. There's teachers who aren't in it, you know what I mean? But with cops, it's like, do you really spend your entire shift just being a cop? Like, what are you doing? And I know a lot of cops who personally, you know, are on another level, but as a whole, where we're having all these situations, it's evidently problems with the cops. You know, a lot of it's lack of training, or if it's not lack of training, then, you know,
I'm biased, bro, because I got picked on by cops when I was younger, man. So I'm a little bit biased. but then my brother is like, he's totally, you know, he has like some of his good friends are cops and they're actually really good dudes, but they do the same thing. They profile as well. So like I'm biased in that sense, but really I think when they talk about defunding, it's like, I don't know. Yeah. Let's end on a positive note.
Well, look, man, like I said, for people that don't know, man, this is the longest we've ever talked. And like I said, man, it's not an interview. I wish more people, like the relationships that we had at Valley were because we were willing to get out of our comfort zone and we were willing to go meet new people, which is important. You know, if you have the ability to, I think everyone needs to get outside of that comfort zone and go meet new people, whether it's go to school or whatever. But like I said, man, it's been nice just conversating, man. Like it's just talking to you now, like catching up, you know, it's like, you know, we could go right back to where we were, you know, 15 years ago. You know what I'm saying? Like that time just kind of goes
away. I think
away,
that's, you know, the cure, bro. Should I just go and like buy a house and just throw parties with just everybody just coming and we just hang out? Like, I think that could be the cure, bro. Like, if we all just experience Valley for like 3 years, we could all be, it could all be a better world.
Well, some parts of America would try to shut us down because we have more than a certain amount of people in an area without masks and this and that. So, you know, we'd have to try to find a place. Hey, maybe they ain't looking in Itabena, man. We need to meet back up in Itabena. But oh, wait. The SWAC moved their football season to the spring. So that's.
I think we should do it in Baton Rouge, bro. Baton Rouge is tight.
Baton Rouge, it ain't terrible.
It ain't terrible.
I don't know, man. I appreciate you guys. You guys are doing it. You guys are having good conversations on here.
Well, like so, I said, Trey,
I didn't, Trey, I honestly didn't realize how stupid you were, bro.
Yeah. I mean, it's, that's why I got Reed here, you know? Like, that's why I have to talk to people to get educated, you know?
I'm just kidding, bro. That's the good part, though, the fact that you can get on here and just ask questions and kind of just ask from that, like you don't watch anything, so like you literally are just asking questions from this just honest, genuine place. So I think that's really good, bro.
Well, I appreciate it. Malcolm keeps me updated, you know. He's definitely told me a few things. Like, I didn't even really, you know about a lot of stuff like y'all were talking about before we came on, but it is what it is, man. Like, I focus on me and what's around me, but I definitely want to know what's going on with my friends to see how y'all are doing. And like I said, man, we'll have to check in again. It's been great just having another perspective, you know, from someone, you know, so far away from where we are. And like I said, man, anything you wanted to add before, man, anything you wanted to add before, you know, we get off, you know, feel free, man, whether it's what you're doing right now and where you're headed. Like I said, just as a friend, I'd love to know, you know, because it's been a while since we chatted.
Yeah, no, I honestly just think that, like, I really have a soft spot for our youth nowadays. And I think anything that we can do with the youth and kind of sharing our stories, like, When I tell these 12, 13, 14-year-old kids that I went to a historically Black college and they're, you know, they're growing up in Southern California the same way I did, right? Like, I had no idea what it was going to be like when I showed up at Valley, and just kind of sharing those stories from like a good place in my heart and saying like, hey, like, I spent weekends in the projects, like, these places exist. And like, some people are struggling, and really just showing like your vulnerability, the fact that, like, you know, I'm the same way you are. Like, I'm 35 years old and I feel the same way you do as a 15-year-old. I've been there, and sometimes I'm still there, and just kind of like supporting these kids and just guiding them and not throwing your opinions or your biases at them, just sharing your story and helping the youth, because right now our youth is struggling. As a whole, we're struggling. But I think that what you guys do working with the youth is great. Even if you don't work with the youth in your normal job, like you guys as teachers, I really encourage just everybody to just do something on the side where you can influence 10, 15 teenagers, 10, 15, 10 to 12 year olds, you know, whatever you Absolutely. Can do. I'm trying to get to a massive amount of like a million, but that doesn't have to happen from everybody. Like, that'd be cool, but you know, that's where my heart is really, I feel we're still broken. We're still medicating our youth. We're still younger and younger. We're giving kids Adderall and all these medications. Please share with them the knowledge that you've learned about food and education and business and saving money and all this stuff that you guys have learned, not just, hey, like, it's wrong to feel that way. You shouldn't feel that way. It's like, hey, I felt that way. It's okay to cry. Doesn't mean you got to take medication. Doesn't mean you got to take this. It's like, hey, eat better, get some exercise and, you know, try to go experience new things. So that's what I'm up to. I'm really just a mental performance coach, because I know that the mental part is really, I spend a lot of my time with men, you know, men commit suicide, men commit suicide three times more than women, bro. Like it's a serious thing. And you know, I try to create communities where men can feel a place where they can cry, they can be openly gay or whatever the heck they want. Like you can be whatever the hell you want. So I guess that's all I can really say at this point. I don't want to take too much more of a time. We've already been on for 2 hours, 2.5 hours, bro.
Hey man, that's good.
That just means we miss each other.
Yeah, it's all. No, man, I agree with you. I wish more people had children in their hearts like you, man. I definitely agree with you on that, man. We do need to, you know, with today's technology, we look at our kids like they're already supposed to be adults. You know what I mean? At 6, 7, 8 years old, and they've got the world at their fingertips, but you know, not enough people are getting real with them and talking to them. You know, so I appreciate it, man. Like I said, I've learned a lot. Just in our short time together. So, but that's what, look, Zach, that's what we encourage people to do, man. Go talk, just talk to people. You know what I mean?
Listen, bro.
Just conversate, learn, and disagree. It's all good. Anyway, young Malcolm, what you got?
You know, I just want to say thank you, Zach, bro. You know, I appreciate you coming on and spending all this time, you know, away from your family to spend with us. You know, we've been doing this show for a while now, and you know, we're trying to build and trying, you know, diverse conversations and share experiences and perspectives, man. And yours is one that I always appreciate. You know, I've been following what you got going on with the mental coach stuff, and you know, the mental preparation for competition. And I kind of like share some of the stuff with my players that I coach. So, you know, as much as I can follow you and you know, take, you know, advice or whatever you got going and continue to connect, you know, just like I, you know, connect with Trey and as many other friends that we got from Valley, and the time that we had that was special. And really, you know, we trying our best to keep those connections strong. So, you know, just keep doing what you're doing. And I just want to say how much I appreciate you coming on and being with us tonight, and same thing for everybody else who was in the chat, in the comments, you know, showing us love, because this is, I love doing this with Trey and opening these conversations and showing people that they can be had without anybody getting upset with each other. Me and Trey don't agree with everything, and I don't know everything, and he don't either, so we trying to learn from each other as much as possible. So
I appreciate y'all, man. I appreciate y'all, dude. So I mean, it's about creating proficient human beings over professional prospects, dude. So just keep on encouraging people, dude. It's not only about sports, not only about one thing. It's just about being a good person and showing up for the next person.
So, hey, man, that's why I love you. That's why I appreciate y'all,
man. Thanks for having me on. It's a good conversation. Sheena's probably trying to go to sleep now. I've been in the bedroom. Like,
dude, I haven't even fed my kids dinner. I mean, I've been here for hours. Anyway,
I love y'all, man. Keep doing it. I'll see you guys sometime next time.
All right, Zach. Take care, man. I don't even know what that is, dude.
You gotta watch the movie, bro. You gotta watch Black Panther, man.
I'll watch Black Panther.
I'm not talking to you again until you watch Black Panther, dude.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough.
All right.
See you.
Peace, y'all.
Peace, bro.
All right, young Reed. I'm gonna let you. That was whoo, man.
2 hours, bro.
That was fun.
Chopping this up and putting it on YouTube, man. Intervals.
Tell Carista that, you know, she can chop it up for us. You know, if she's got time. Anyway, you tell Max and Malachi I said hello. When you see him.
Oh, dude, man. You give Josh a noogie and Ava a kiss.
Okay, man. I'm gonna leave it with you. And like, man, look, if anybody heard anything interesting, you know, like I said, if you enjoyed anything, then please support us, because you know, we hope that we're trying to speak the right messages to the majority of people, you know, that share similar views like us, that want to help do things. So, once again, Malcolm, I've enjoyed the talk, man. I'll until next time.
Did you notice our third show this week, bro? We have been on the air three times.
Really?
This week. Okay. Yeah, I guess we got some momentum going. I don't know what it is. People rocking with us, so we rock.
All right, Reed. I appreciate you doing what you do, man.
Same, bro. Same.
All right. I'm going to talk to you next week. Peace.
All right, bro. Okay. All right, that's it. Trey's gone. Zach's gone. It's just me. My jersey is offensive. Probably going to be the last Indians jersey that I own because our name's going to get changed soon. Anyway, Vic, thanks for that comment. All right, y'all. I am going to say goodnight for Chestnut Checkers podcast / Facebook Live TV show on behalf of Three Butts and myself. Thank y'all for coming out. God bless you. Good night. Peace.